Good day and welcome to Big Bad Tech. I'm your instructor, Jim Pytel. During this short application exercise, we're going to examine some hypothetical troubleshooting scenarios using the two-wire magnetic motor starter hand-off auto circuit we created in a prior application exercise. Before we begin, realize the first step to troubleshooting any system is to understand how it is intended to operate. Anyone that tells you anything different is wrong. This lecture therefore operates under the presumption you've watched the preceding lectures detailing the principle of operation and construction of the two-wire magnetic motor starter hand-off auto circuit. Keep in mind, there is no limit to the wrong that can happen. Problems manifest themselves in many numbers and in many forms, and sometimes the same external symptom can be rooted in very different sources. This being said, I'd like to discuss and intentionally induce some faults in this circuit for the purposes of familiarizing you with the observed results. If at a later date you observe these same fault conditions, you'll at least have the luxury of having seen it once before. Recall our two-wire magnetic motor starter hand-off auto circuit, as implemented in the above-reference lectures, used a maintained contact, three-position selector switch, and a push button, standing in for a float switch, to control the operation of a motor-driven pump. An operator could place the circuit in one of three modes: auto, where the simulated float switch automatically controls the motor; hand, which turns the motor on whether the simulated float switch calls for it or not; or off, which halts the motor even if the simulated float switch closes. You should realize that this circuit exhibits certain expected behaviors that, although potentially undesirable, are not to be considered troubleshooting events, but are rather byproducts of the as-constructed nature of this circuit. A technician knowledgeable of basic technical principles and this circuit's intended function can predict this behavior and take the necessary precautions. For example, consider the response of this system to a sudden loss and restoration of power or an overload event. Recall that this two-wire circuit exhibits low or no voltage release characteristics, in that if power is lost and restored, the system can suddenly start if the automatic input is still being triggered at the time of power up. Consider what happens in auto mode when the simulated float switch is activated and the manual motor starter opened, simulating a loss to the primary circuit only. As predicted, the motor free spins to a halt. Note, however, the green pilot lamp is still illuminated and the contactor is still being closed, indicating the pilot level ladder logic is still calling for action. If the simulated float switch remains closed when primary power is restored, the motor suddenly energizes. Any technician investigating this halted motor has the possibility of being injured or killed. It is for this reason lockout and tagout procedures are such an important daily practice. Additionally, consider this circuit's response to an overload event caused by a large mechanical load, a locked rotor, or a single phasing event. Consider what would happen if the overload relay was in the automatic reset mode. In this case, I'm simulating an overload event by pushing in the manual test button. The triggered overload element signals the contactor to open as expected. When the overload element automatic mode cools, i.e. when I stop triggering it, it automatically resets. If the simulated float switch is still being triggered, again, the motor springs to life unexpectedly. Any technician investigating this overloaded motor has the possibility of being injured or killed. Certain scenarios may call for a hand reset of the overload that requires a technician confirm and manually reset the overload when it is safe to do so. Proper lockout and tagout procedures would prevent such an unfortunate occurrence from happening. Let's examine some additional hypothetical scenarios and discuss the robustness of this system and how it responds positively or negatively to these situations. Let's say the float switch refuses to close due to some errant debris being hung up in the mechanism or a break in a wire. In this case, I've simulated a malfunctioning float switch by removing wire 4 from the 2-4 terminal of the normally open push button, our simulated float switch. When the system is placed in auto mode, the repeated actuation of the disconnected float switch serves no purpose. The level in the tank begins to rise to dangerous levels. If an operator switched to hand mode, the malfunctioning float switch is bypassed and the motor-driven pump springs to life and saves the day. The selector switch, with a manual bypass, therefore serves as an emergency backup means of activating the pump. Let's say you leave your lab partner unsupervised, and they mistakenly wire up the circuit using the normally closed side of the selector switch, auto contact. Realize this is not the circuit you intend to build, and it will behave in a manner fundamentally different than what you expect. By all means, pause the lecture and think about the unintended consequences of replacing the normally open side of the auto contact with a normally closed one. When the system is powered on and placed in auto mode, the selector switch has now opened the normally closed auto contact. Repeated actuation of the push button, our simulated float switch, serves no purpose since there is still an open in rung 1. As previously, an operator can switch to hand mode and bypass the malfunctioning logic in rung 1. However, when an operator returns the selector switch to the center off position, the erroneously wired auto contact remains in the deactivated closed state. A potentially dangerous scenario lies coiled and waiting to strike. Even though the selector switch is in the intended off mode, the closure of the push button, our simulated float switch, the motor springs to life. Totally opposite of the intended purpose of the off mode. Let this be a lesson you never need to learn again. The erroneous wiring of a circuit can have life-threatening consequences. Always wire the circuit as intended and dutifully inspect and confirm your work. As I previously mentioned, there is no limit to the wrong that can happen, and part of these infinite possibilities is the very real prospect that you are working on a circuit very different than the one you think you are working on. For this reason, never trust anyone, least of all your lab partner. If your safety depends on it, I am more than comfortable with you tying your lab partner to the flagpole out front while you work on your lab. Consider an open in wire 4 leading to the A1 terminal of the M1 contactor coil. Given wire 4 is best thought of as a node, in reality, this open can occur in several different places, all of which exhibit different undesirable behaviors. If the wire 4 open occurs in rung 1, immediately after the 2-4 terminal of the push button, our simulated float switch, only the logic in rung 1 is undesirably affected. When in auto mode, the closure of the float switch will not start the motor. If, however, the selector switch is moved to hand mode, the logic in rung 1 is bypassed and the motor starts. If the wire 4 open occurs in rung 2, immediately after the 4-4 terminal of the selector switch hand contact, only the logic in rung 2 is undesirably affected. When in auto mode, the closure of the float switch starts the motor as expected. If, however, the selector switch is moved to hand mode, the motor will not start. Finally, if the wire 4 open occurs at the A1 terminal of the coil, neither the logic in rung 1 or rung 2 will start the motor. A mission-critical operation might disastrously fail given neither the automatic or hand bypass can effectively energize the M1 contactor coil. For this reason, allow me to expound upon my definition of nodes and comment on robustness and reliability. While it is true that wire 4 is best thought of as a node, being the pooled connection of the 4-4 terminal of the selector switch hand contact, the 2-4 terminal of the simulated float switch, and the A1 terminal of the M1 contactor coil. In practice, it might be better to run a wire directly from the 4-4 terminal of the selector switch hand contact to the A1 terminal of the M1 contactor coil, and another entirely separate wire from the 2-4 terminal of the simulated float switch to the A1 terminal of the M1 contactor coil for reasons of robustness and reliability. This way, in the event the wire to the contactor coil is severed from the logic in rung 1, rung 2 is there to bypass the automatic input. Similarly, in the event the wire to the contactor coil is severed from the logic in rung 2, rung 1 is there to automatically govern the system. While my earlier description of wires as nodes is semantically correct, mission-critical operations may need this level of consideration when it comes to routing additional wires. For reasons of robustness and reliability, I would ensure a wire 4 from rung 1 and another entirely separate wire 4 from rung 2 are both landed on terminal A1 of the M1 contactor coil. Consider this circuit where I've purposely disconnected all wires leading to the A1 terminal of the M1 contactor coil. Neither the auto mode with the simulated float switch closed nor the hand mode serves to start the motor. What's a technician to do? Obviously, the correct answer is to fix the system and wire the system as intended. However, consider a mission-critical response to a dangerous situation that requires immediate attention. All hell is about to break loose unless the M1 contactor closes pronto. What would you do? By all means, pause the lecture and think about this. After all, you've only got 5 seconds to do so before all hell breaks loose. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. The answer, quite simply, is to close the contactor. Warning, do not try this at home. For this simple circuit, a technician can quite simply manually close the contactor using the manual override on the front and keep forcing it closed until the system can be stopped and serviced. For obvious reasons, this is not the preferred method when dealing with a larger, more complicated system, necessitating coordination and relying upon safety-critical interlocks. However, for this system, the manual closure of the contactor results in the motor starting. While inelegant and admittedly potentially dangerous for larger systems, the triggered manual override is effectively closing the primary contacts, as would an energized contactor coil. Quite like a piece of sharp glass wrapped in a fabric handle or a heavy padlock stuffed in a pillowcase, it's brutal, but it gets the job done, if you know what I'm saying. If there is anything you can take away from this demonstration, it is this. A system will do what you tell it or force it to do. Keep in mind, electrically controlled systems are not thinking systems, but merely soulless machines that respond to input and issue output. If you tell a system to drill a hole in your hand or force it to destroy itself, it will do so without a moment of hesitation or regret. All right, this about wraps up this brief application exercise. In conclusion, we examined some troubleshooting scenarios for the two-wire magnetic motor starter hand-off auto circuit. We examined the circuit's response to loss and restoration of power, overloads, malfunctioning automatic input, improperly wired input, the effects of opens in different areas of the circuit, and the effects of manual overrides. Again, keep in mind there is no limit to the wrong that can happen. My intention in creating this resource was to introduce and familiarize you with a couple common troubleshooting scenarios you can put in your pocket and whip out at a later date. Remember, troubleshooting is not a skill separate from a thorough understanding of basic technical principles, but rather troubleshooting is the systematic and efficient application of basic technical principles. The first step to troubleshooting any system is to understand how it is intended to operate in the first place. Anyone that tells you anything different is wrong. Thank you very much for your attention and interest, and we'll see you again during the next lecture of our series. Remember to tell your Lazy Lab partner about this resource. Be sure to check out the Big Bad Tech channel for additional resources and updates.